So, as what we discussed yesterday, first of all, we need to import the required classes of the Mosquito protocol. So, the first five lines will always remain the same. You import the required classes of the Mosquito protocol. So, Mosquito client, Mosquito connection options, Mosquito exception, Mosquito message, and for persistence, means saving the state of the object forever. If you look at the Java programming language, Java says if you want a serialization to occur, means for a persistence property to hold true, you must implement the serializable interface. Means your class, the Java class, Java program should implement the serializable interface. Now that is one way how we go for serialization in Java. Another is we go for memory persistence. Persistence itself means you are saving the state of the object for longer duration of time. Now, what does that actually mean in IoT context? When the data is getting shared between the publisher to the broker or from the broker to the subscriber, it is on the network for a small duration of time. Now, at that point of time, you want the network to take care of, means intermediate routers, switches, gateways, that they should make sure if the state of the object should not get disturbed. And that is why we say Mosquito protocol works over the TCP protocol. TCP support connection oriented. So all the packet will go sequentially one by one over the what you call TLS transport layer, security layer, connection oriented layer, so that they reach safely from source to destination. So persistence is a choice, but then in IoT they always say you have to do it. There is no way you can bypass the persistence property for the Mosquito protocol. Then we import util and the SQL. Why SQL? Because we will do a connectivity with the database. Whatever data a publisher prints onto the broker window, broker will forward it to the subscriber, and subscriber will have a database and he will archive that information within a database. So we will use a MySQL server, and MySQL server may we will archive the information, persist the data which the subscriber is receiving from the broker. So that's the main aim of the program. Routing in IoT using the MQTT protocol, publish subscriber approach. And let's come to the class. So we define a class Mosquito publish subscriber. So MQTT pub sub publisher subscriber. Then we define a main function. And as we have discussed yesterday in the main function, the only thing what I can change in this entire line of code is the name of the string array, nothing else. Rest everything has to be as it is. I cannot change anything. Everything has to remain as it is. Only thing is that I can change the name of the array. Then we come to the line number 14 and we define a topic. So we string class variable called topic, and here we say the publisher is going to print the value for temperature. So the topic become temperature. Now what value of temperature? So we define a string class variable called content, and we'll say let the user input the value. Now in Java, again we remember for command line arguments we write args, the name of the string array, and the index position. Now since the subscripting start from zero, indexing start from zero, so we say arg zero. So in the command line argument we will pass the value of the temperature, and then we postfix degree Celsius as a value with unit for. Now quality of service, again there are three quality of service, 0, 1 and 2. So right now we take intermediate level of quality of service and we say hardcode the value as 1. Broker, we need to start the broker. Either we can connect to the broker of the eclipse.org, but again in authentication process they will not allow us unless and until our name and our IP address is there in the access control list of the eclipse.org. So they might refuse it. And I have seen majority of the time they just bypass it. They refuse the connections to the broker unless and you are registered with the Eclipse Foundation. So what we do, we run the broker on our own system. So what the line of code, TCP colon 2 forward slash localhost colon 1882. So either I can write a localhost or I can write the default loopback IP address. Now why do we say loopback IP address? Because the packet get generated and the packet get consumed on the same layer. So OSI model works on your layer, on your system. So source and destination is your system only. You source OSI model generates the packet, and the destination OSI model consumes the packet, and everything happens on this your machine. So it's a default loopback. Loopback means looping the packets onto your machine IP address. Then we make a call to no argument constructor memory persistence class. This has to be done so that we can get access to a persistence reference variable. So memory persistence, persistence equal to new memory persistence. Now Java always advises us that whenever you are doing database programming, which we are doing in this program, whenever you're dealing with files like streams, readers, writers, Java provides stream like file input stream, buffered input stream, data input stream, file output stream. So many kind of streams are there. So whenever we are dealing with the streams, we are dealing with the readers and writers, we need to write the code within the try catch. Now what kind of code do we write in the try? The code which is likely to fall flat, the code which is likely to collapse, the code which is vulnerable in nature. And even though you write the best of the code, then also the exception might get thrown, right? So for handling that exception, we must handle within a catch block or finally block. The difference between the two, catch will only execute once the exception is thrown. However, finally will always get executed irrespective of the fact whether exception will be thrown or not. So we must handle the exception which might get generated during the execution of the program. So we write the code within the try. Now we need to handle the publishers and subscribers. Now one option is that I hard code the values for subscribers as well as publisher. Another is I ask the Mosquito protocol to generate it for me. So what do we do here? We make a call to a function called generate client ID. So automatically it will, every programming language have got something called PRNGs. Pseudo random number generators. So it will generate client ID, will make a call to PRNG, and it will randomly generate any free client ID for you. So if you run this program 10 times on 10 different machines, different kind of client ID will get generated. So what do we do with this function resides in the Mosquito client class. Now again, as a Java coding convention, if there's a class name and the class name comprises of two words, like we have a Mosquito and the client, the first alphabet of both of them will be in the uppercase. But when you are calling a function name, the first alphabet of the first word goes in the lowercase. And subsequently, first alphabet of every next word goes in the uppercase. That's a good programming practice in Java. And Java makes sure that you implemented that because it's a very case sensitive language. So here G goes in the lowercase and C goes in the uppercase. And again, I goes in the uppercase. So we make a call to a function called generate client ID. And as I have written in the comment entry, automatic generation of the subscriber ID will take place for you. Now, where do we store this information? We create a string class variable called subscriber ID, and we archive this information, the newly generated ID for us. And then we display it to the user also that this is a subscriber ID which has been generated for you by the Mosquito client class. So with system.out.println, generated subscriber ID is subscriber ID. So one subscriber is now getting ready. Now we need to attach it to broker. So what do? We do association. And for association, what do? We make a call to three argument constructor of the Mosquito client class, passing the information of broker as a first parameter, subscriber ID as a second parameter, and the persistence property as a third parameter. So we pass the three information, three parameter information in the three parameters to the constructor of the Mosquito client class. So it's a parameterized constructor, three parameters being passed to it. If everything is fine and well, we get the information in the subscriber preference variable of the Mosquito client class. So our subscriber is ready and we have also associated with the broker and persistence property has been set to true. So these three lines does the task of subscriber generation only and association with the broker. Now we replicate the same task for publisher also. In the previous program, we have hard coded the publisher. Now we are not doing that. We are taking the help of the generate client ID function. And what we are expecting it for it, same thing what it is in the previous lines of code. We do the automatic generation, make a call to PRNGs, pseudo random number generators. And it generates the whatever free client ID is that generated for, and we store it into a reference variable of the string class called publisher ID, and we also display the same information to the user. System.out.println generated publisher ID is, and the value of the publisher ID which has got generated. However, in any of these two cases, if the generate client ID function fails, immediately exception will be thrown and the program will stop at their own. But assuming everything is fine, we can move on to the next line. And what do we do? Just what we did for subscriber, we make a call to three argument constructor of the Mosquito client class and pass the information about broker, publisher ID and the persistence, right? So after the culmination of line number 27, our publisher is ready and our broker is ready. Almost the line of code are same. When we are taking the help of the generate client ID function for us, it will do automatic generation both for publisher and for the subscriber. Now, what do we do after line number 27? We come to the Mosquito connection option class. So we make a call to no argument constructor of the Mosquito connection option class. Why we are doing it? Because we want to set the timeout interval, the timeout window, how long the connection should be there between publisher to broker, from broker to subscriber. So we make a call to the function called set connection timeout. So the connection, now here we're talking of the logical connection over the network, will remain alive, will remain there for a period of 60 seconds. So 60 seconds, the connection will be there, supported by the network, and after that will be closed. So we make a call to set connection timeout function for that. Then we set the Mosquito version. So again, we make a the use of the connection option reference variable, make a call to a function called set Mosquito version, and then whichever version you are using. So right now I'm using my systems 3.1. So Mosquito connection options dot Mosquito underscore version underscore 3.1. So instead of writing 3.1, we write 3.1. Now one of the most important line of code in this entire program is clearing of the streams, clearing of the sessions, because it may happen the session might have the garbage value. So just like we used to make a called flush stdin in C and C++, Java provides us this set clean session. So connection option dot set clean session, by default the value of the boolean variable is false, so you have to explicitly set it to true. And where does this function reside? In the Mosquito connection option class. So class name, reference variable, reference variable dot function, right? So in the line number 32, we are done with the setting of the connection options for the data exchange is going to take place for us. Now the line number 33, I've written the comment just to make sure that the code become understandable to you. Subscriber connects to the broker. So system.out.println connecting to the broker, and we display the information about the broker, that who is this broker. So information get displayed. Also, these are the small steps for troubleshooting, for debugging. At what line of code your program might fail. So at the time of troubleshooting, you can come to know, you can write multiple SOP statements, system.out.println statement, that we can help you debug the program. Okay, my program is working fine till line number 34, and thereafter only I need to troubleshoot it. Then line number 35, what do we make a call to the connect function. Now this is an important function for establishing a connection. So subscriber, and he makes a call to the connect function. Now if you look at the subscriber is a reference variable of the Mosquito client, right? So we are making a call to the connect function here, and we pass a connection option as a parameter. So all these values which we have set here, set clean session true, Mosquito version, connection timeout, will get activated for us. Now subscriber can subscribe for one topic, or he can subscribe for multiple topic with the broker. So we say subscriber dot subscribe function and the topic. So here I am just dealing with one topic, but also I could write the line of code and I say string topic one, and I say is equal to pressure, right? So now we have got two topics. So broker can have multiple kind of topics on itself. So here we are dealing with one topic, but yes, you can have multiple topics: atmospheric temperature, pressure, humidity, soil conditions, seismic vibration protection of the earthquake. So many kind of the topics can be there as such. So here we are dealing in this program one topic, but yes, I can have multiple topics within my program. And then I need to use the reference variable. So when I say here the line of code as subscriber dot subscribe, and I specify the topic, topic one, topic two, topic three, topic four. So subscription has to be done on a specific topic. Then I say if this line of code becomes successful, then I say system.out.println subscriber connected. Else it will throw the exception that connection could not be established or subscription fails, and then it will come to the catch block. And then we need to debug that what is the real problem, why it has not been able to register or subscribe to the broker for this particular topic. Now we are done with the subscriber. Subscriber is successfully connected to the broker. If not, it will throw the exception. If yes, we come to the line number 40, and here publisher connects to the broker now, because one part is done. If you just summarize the program, what I have done till line number 40, I created a publisher ID. I did not hard coded the value. I asked the Mosquito protocol, and it made a call to pseudo random number generator, and whatever the free value was found, one ID was reserved for publisher, one ID was reserved for publisher, and one for subscriber. Then we set the connection options. Then the subscriber connected to the broker for a specific topic, which is temperature here. But yes, he can also register for multiple topics. Now the publisher makes an entry. What does the publisher do? First of all, publisher connects with the connection option. So publisher.connect, and we set all the connection options. So we are using three connection options here: timeout in window, then the Mosquito version, as well as cleaning the session, set clean session function, setting the value as true. As we have discussed yesterday also, most of the algorithms and most of the protocol works on bytes rather than on strings, because C and C++ are byte oriented. But in Java, the string is 16-bit wide, multi-byte character set, or Unicode, what we say. So here, what we have to do, we have to fetch the bytes from the string. For that, we have got a class called Mosquito Message class. So we make a call to one argument constructor of the Mosquito Message class and pass this as a parameter, content.getBytes, means fetch the bytes, get the byte from the string variable called content. And what are the value of the content? It is something which is going to be input by the user. Because if you see here, we are receiving it as a command line argument from the user. So we really do not know what kind of value is going to provide it to us. So we come down to back to the same line. Yeah. So information is received into a Mosquito message class reference variable called message. What does it actually mean? The message is a reference variable pointing to a location in a memory where the bytes equivalent of the strings are there. And now we need to set the quality of service. So we can have 0, 1, and 2. So here in this program, we are setting the values 1. So we make a call to set quality of service function and pass the value of the QoS variable, which is 1. Hard coded here right at the top. Also, we can receive the same value from the user, that what kind of quality of service he expects from the Mosquito protocol of the IoT. 0, 1, or 2. That is also we can do. So we can receive the value in the args 1. That is also absolutely possible. Or if you don't want to give this permission or access to the user, you can define from your own side. Right? So done with the quality of service. Now the publisher has to do the job of publishing. So publisher prints or publish. What it publish? First of all, it has to specify temperature topic. Topic is a temperature in this case. Now what value corresponding to that topic? It comes in the message. Now what does the message contain? The byte equivalent of the string called content. And from where the value of content is coming, the user is giving to us temperature, right? So first of all, the topic name, and then the corresponding value for that topic. Then the line number 45, if it is done, then we say system.out.println message has been published. Else immediately exception will be thrown that publisher is not able to publish the message onto the broker window. Assuming everything is fine, we move to the next line of code, line number 46. Now publisher vanishes. He disconnects, because publisher will never remain in the connected state for long. He will come, connect, print, and then close down the connection. So he will disconnect it immediately as such. So publisher publishes and exits. And if it successfully happens, we just display a SOP statement, system.out.println, and disconnect. Now what should happen logically next? The subscriber will receive the topic and the message from the broker. So what does the subscriber do? He makes a call to get topic function and he passes the parameter for which topic he would like to fetch the value. Now again, as I said, there could be multiple topics: atmospheric temperature, pressure, humidities, soil condition, any kind of the topic would be there. So you need to specify what kind of topic: one, topic two, topic three, topic four. So get topic is the name of the function, but then within the parameter you have to specify what kind of topic you would like to get from the broker. Means if you are a subscriber, what kind of information you would like to fetch from the broker. So we display it in the line number 51. In the 52, we display the same statement: system.out.println received message is subscriber.getTopic and the content. So we are able to fetch the value for that particular content. Now what will the subscriber do? Now here from the line number 53, our JDBC code start. Because now subscriber has received the value, right? Now he has to persist it forever. There are two ways. Either you create a file, a sequential file, what we call CSV file also, and wherein you can archive this information. Or you connect to a database and you store the information within the database forever. Now here in this program, for the JDBC, I'm using the MySQL server. So what does the JDBC code suggest us? We make a call to the forName function of the java.lang.system class. So class is a name of a class. ForName is a name of the function. Since again the forName contain two words, so F goes in the lowercase, N goes in the uppercase. And then we specify the name of the driver class, which is used to connect to a backend, front-end to backend connectivity. So I need to load and register the driver class for the corresponding database. So if I'm using the MySQL, I will say com.mysql.cj.jdbc.driver. This is just a name of the driver class and has to be written as it is, the way the MySQL people have defined it. If I'm using the Oracle as a backend, so oracle.jdbc.driver.oracle-driver. So it depends upon me what kind of database I've got. So I need to write the appropriate class for dealing with that kind of the database. So I say Oracle lowercase dot JDBC dot driver dot Oracle driver. And then I can connect to the Oracle database. So I need to be very specific that what I'm looking for, what is my database in the backend. So I make a call to that appropriate driver class. Now once the driver class has been loaded and registered, now this code will work only if you download the jar file for this driver. Otherwise you will not be able to connect to the MySQL server. So you need to download the two things has to be done in your machine. First of all, you need to download the MySQL server. It's a free of cost open source. You don't have to pay anything to anybody. So you download it and then carry out the installation of it, configure it on your machine, and it should work out because there's no problem with the MySQL servers. MySQL server by and large works successfully fine on every machine. With lightweight resources, they don't consume much of the resources on your machine. And also you at the step number 5 or 6, they will ask for the port number, because MySQL server is a server. It will receive a request on a specific port number. And as we have discussed earlier also, port number is a 16-bit number. So total number of port number available is 2^16, 0 to 65535. Now out of them, 0 to 1023 are reserved, but 1024 onward they are available for the companies. How long? Till 49,000. So MySQL as a company has reserved the port number 3306. So always the MySQL server receives the request on the port number 3306. Now that's a default port number. However, as a system administrators, we can always change the default port number. But my experience is, don't do it. These servers give their best performance only on their default port numbers. So unless and until there's a dire necessity that you have to change it, then only you change it. Otherwise, keep the default port number as it is. So once in the step number 5 or 6, when I'm carrying out the installation of MySQL server, I have set the port number as 3030 because it will ask me. It will ask me what kind of user ID you want, what is the password you want, what is the port number you want. So I need to specify these things. And if you are not good in remembering the things, make sure you write in some notepad or wordpad file and save it on your system so that you do not have to have a problem of remembering the things forever. So once the driver has got loaded and registered on my machine, I come to line number 56 and I make a call to the getConnection function of the driver manager class. And what do I do here? Now, this is a code specific to MySQL. It varies from database to database. So I say JDBC colon MySQL colon to forward slash localhost, because the MySQL server is currently being running on my machine. In reality, in real time, I will give the IP address of the web server or IP address of the database server where MySQL has been installed. But here, since I installed on my machine, I'm referring to as a localhost. And then the port number 3306. Now, within that MySQL server, which is the database you are using? So Vault is a default database in the MySQL. So I'm using the default database. So this becomes the first parameter. Abhilasha, go in the mute state. So what do we do in the getConnection function? The first parameter, we pass the information about the MySQL server. We pass the information about the IP address of the machine on which the MySQL server is installed. We specify the port number and we specify the name of a database within the MySQL server. So by default, Vault is one of the database, a predefined database available in the MySQL server. Then in the second and third parameters to this getConnection function, I specify the user ID and I specify the password for it. So root and the tool. You can give any password of your choice. You can give any user ID of your choice on your machine when you are carrying out the installation of the MySQL server. So all these three parameters are passed in the getConnection function of the driver manager class. Now your front-end Java program will try to establish a connection to the backend database on this line number 56. If it is successful, we will get the connection information into this connection class reference variable called connection. So connection is the name of a class. This is the name of the reference variable. And now you can give any name of the reference variable, but just for the sake of simplicity, I'm using the same name. But it's your choice. You can give any name for the connection class. Now we make a call to the function called create statement from the connection class. So class name, reference variable dot function name, create statement. If it is successful, it returns me the statement interface object called the statement. And what do I do with this statement? Why I have written this line number 57? Because I need to make a call to the function called execute update. Now the information or the definition of the execute update is available with the statement and not with the connection. So that is the only logic of making a call to the line number 57. That once the connection information is available to you, you make a call to create a statement function of the connection class. If it is successful, it will return me the statement class object called the statement. Now using that statement, I make a call to the execute update function. And what do I do in this? I insert the row which the subscriber has received from the broker. So I say insert into IoT MQTT. That's the name of the table. And just like we write the query, the SQL query. So insert into table name values. And I pass on the values of the publisher, the broker. So how do we write it? That's the syntax. Apostrophes, quotation marks, plus publisher, plus quotation marks and apostrophes. So first value for the, it gets inserted into the table of the database. Then I store the value for broker, that who was the publisher for this record, who was the broker, then who am I, subscriber, I also store my information. Then what topic was there? It was a temperature. So again, apostrophes, quotation mark, plus, then the name of the variable, plus quotation marks and the apostrophes, and then finally the content for it. And then closing, quotation marks, parenthesis, and the semicolon. So in this way, I insert a record which contain all the values for that specific record, the publisher, the broker, the subscriber, the topic, and the content. Now, if this record gets successfully inserted into a table of a database, execute update function will return me the integer value, how many number of record has been inserted. So right now I'm inserting only one record. So I create an integer variable called num1, which will hold on to the return value of the execute update function. Right? Then I say number of rows entered as number. How many number of rows entered? Whatever is the value of the number variable will go and get displayed. And then I hang up the connection. I close it down. So connection dot close, because publisher is printed onto the broker. Broker has passed all the information to subscriber. Subscriber connected to the database using JDBC, and the database server uses the MySQL, and it has inserted a record into the table of the database. And what is the name of the table? IoT MQTT, right? And then we come to the catch. If any problem arises in any line of code in this program, so we'll can handle it with the catch. So either I can use multiple Mosquito connection, just like what we discussed as Mosquito exception class, or simply I have made a call to super class exception, exception, and then whatever kind of exception it's thrown, it will throw the exception and I can handle. I need to troubleshoot it. Okay, so that is how the program has been done. Now what we need to do, we need to compile the program, establish a connection with the MySQL server, start a broker, and then run a program. So these are the minimum things we need to do. But first thing first, we need to download the MySQL server on our machines, configure it and install it. Once you have done, and during this process of configuration and installation, make sure you set the user ID, make sure you set the right password, and then you specify the port number 3306. And then you must remember these user ID and password so that you don't have a problem accessing the contents of the database later on. So if you're not remembering, if you're not good in remembering the things, make sure you write in some notepad or WordPad file so that you can access it later on when there's a problem. Now, once the MySQL server is there in place, what do we do next? We need to download the jar file. So I have already downloaded the jar file. And once I've downloaded the jar file, just like what we did for the jar file for the Mosquito server, same way we will set the path, the class path for the MySQL server file also. So here you can see on your on my machine, C drive, program files, MySQL, MySQL connector, -java, -8.0.25.jar file. So I have downloaded the jar file from the web, free of cost, you don't have to pay anything to anybody. Free of cost, permissions are, no permissions are required. So download the jar file, and as we always advise that you should save all these things in the program file folders on your C drives. So within the program file folder, I've created a MySQL folder, and this is a location of the jar file on my machine. If I don't do it, my JDBC code will fail. It is as simple as that to understand. So this jar file will, this is the actual, because the name of the jar file is this, the way it is available on the web, mysql-connector-java-8.0.25.jar file. You download it and you store it on your hard disk. And then you set a location in the class path variable to that specific jar file. So the name of jar file is pronounced as this, but when we write within the code, we write com.mysql.cj.jdbc.driver. So this is a string which has to be written in the program, in the code. So this is the name of the driver class, but that is the name of the jar file. So when you write this line of code, it will refer to that jar file, and it will help your Java program to establish a connection to a database. So for the successful execution of the program, for connecting to a database, means talking of the only JDBC code, you must make sure download the jar file for the MySQL server. If you got any other database on your machine, fine. But then you must have a jar file for that particular database too, so that you can set its value into the class path variable. So once you set into a class path variable, then now it is okay. Now it can smoothly connect to a backend database. So for execution of the program, what do we do first? We need to have a database in place, right? Because we are connecting to the JDBC. Through the JDBC, we are connecting to the MySQL server. So assuming that the database is there in place, I log into a database, I give the password, and I'm able to connect to the MySQL server on my machine. Are we able to see the window of the MySQL server? Quick yes or no by anyone? Are we able to see the window of the MySQL server? You can type in the chat window, say yes, sir. Or no.
No, sir.
You're not able to see?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Okay, fine. Yeah. So what do we do next here? Once we have downloaded and configured and installed MySQL Server our machine, we log into a database, because if you've seen the program, what we have written, use world. So world is a default database available on the MySQL. So you can also use the same program and run it on your machine, right? So you use the database somewhere, that because table has to be created in some database. So either we created a database by our own, or we use a default database. So here we, default database has been reused, and the same name is also given in the program. Then we I've created a table, IoT MQTT. So I will just show the schema for the same table. Yeah. So I said describe and the name of a table. So what are the columns here? Publisher ID, broker ID, subscriber ID, topic, and the content. So these are the available column for this table. And for, just for the sake of simplicity, I've kept the data type as character with size as 50. And they don't have to be null. So the value becomes no for the null. Now we can look out for the row, if there is any row present in this table. So select star from IoT MQTT. That's a normal syntax which you write for the SQL query, which I hope everyone is already familiar with. And there is no row, it's an empty set, right? So for the, before the execution of the program starts, make sure your MySQL server is properly done. It is downloaded, installed, and configured. And the jar file is ready. And for the jar file to be used, make sure that we set the value in the class path variable also, because then only we'll be able to connect to a database. Assuming that is done, we log into the SQL server, or if you're using any database of your choice on your machine, if there's all database, you can use that. So we log into the world database. I've created a table called IoT MQTT. So this is a table schema. We're having the five columns: publisher ID, broker ID, subscriber ID, topic, and the content. And right now it is all vacant, it is all empty. So no records are there. Now, we, from the back end, we come to the front end. And what do? Now we start the broker on our machine, because that Mosquito server has to be up and running. So what do? Here we go to the program file, something where I have stored on my machine, and it is advisable that you also save it on your machine on the program file folder. And I start the Mosquito server on my machine. So mosquito.exe-p-p, and I specify the port number 1882. Oh, spelling mistake in the Mosquito. Mosquito.exe-v-p. Yeah. So if we get this line, Mosquito version 2.0.11 running. So that means the cursor is blinking. It is ready to receive the request, both for the IPv4 addressing scheme as well as IPv6 addressing scheme on the socket port. Now, socket is a word which is given to a combination of IP address and port number. So when we refer to the word socket, that means we are referring to the collection of IP address and the port number. And the port number here is a 1882. So first step, we have our SQL server is ready in the backend. The table is, has been created. Table is there in place. And then we came in the front end. We started with the Mosquito server. Now we come to the next step. I open another command prompt window, which will act as a launching platform for carrying out a communication between the publisher to the broker to the subscriber. So I compile the, I go to the folder IoT simulation. I compile the program. Let me copy the name of the program so that there is no problem arises. I copy the right program. Dot Java. So it has created it, and our class file is ready. Now, just before going for the execution of program, we can also have a peep into the content of the class file. What kind of class file it has created for us. So what I can do here is, I go to the IoT simulation folder and I go to the class file mosquito publish sample dot class. Class file, you can see this class file also. Now if you look at this content of this class file, this is where the Java security actually steps in. The entire information is in a bytecode format, not understandable by the normal human beings. So if you start with it, start with the bytecode EP03x4. Then name of the packages, name of the classes, and name of the interfaces, they are kept as it is. So wherever our packages are being the java.lang.string or org.eclipse.paho client mosquito version 3 mosquito connection option, they will remain as it is. But wherever we are writing our own code, right, like for the generation of publisher ID, generation of subscriber ID, setting the value for connection options, then the publisher comes and connect to the broker, that line of code has been converted into the bytecodes so that it's become safe from hackers, it's safe, become safe from the people who might try to intrude into the system and change the code. So if you look at the content of this class file, the name of the corresponding Java packages and interfaces and classes, they will remain as it is. They remain in the string format. But your code, whatever code you have written, for example, the IoT MQTT code which you have written, they will be converted into bytecode. Same way our all MySQL code, if you look at this MySQL code, it's all converted into the bytecode. So proper encryption has been done and the ciphertext has been got generated and the entire code comes in the bytecode format, safe from hacking, so that no person can actually shuffle or change the contents of the class file. That's a security, what we call, there's something called sandbox security model. You can Google on the web, or if you already know about it, good. That provide the inherent security to the Java program. So all the, when you say JDK, Java Development Toolkit, we are referring to Java compiler as well as Java runtime environment, and the JRE includes the JVM, Java Virtual Machine. So all secure code is there, not easily hackable, but yes, something like this normal statement, set quality of service, they will remain as it is, but the value you change, publish the just like the standard things, get reason code was the name of the mosquito exception class, that will remain as it is. So they will remain as it is, by and large everything else will change. It will get converted into bytecode format. So we come to the program and then we launch the program for carrying out communication from the publisher to the broker to the subscriber. And we pass the value of temperature, let's say 16. Now it says generate subscriber ID is PAHO 528331321965800. That's a huge number we can see. Now that has been generated automatically by the Mosquito protocol. We have not done it. We had made a call to the function and we can see that. Now also another thing which we can see is the first six digits, 528313, seven digits, 3 plus 3, 6, 1. Yeah, they remain same for both of them. And it's only the later on digits which have got changed. So it will also be using certain nomenclature for the numbering schemes. So we can see that one has been generated for subscriber, one has been generated for the publisher. And now it is trying to connect to the broker. So now we can come to the broker and see what is happening here. So it has received the value for the temperature, sending the connection back involvement to PAHO client. And let's say come back to the here. It says subscriber connected, message published, then publisher has got disconnected, then the topic was temperature, received message is 16 degrees Celsius, and the number of rows entered is 1. Right? Now we can check whether the data has got successfully inserted into our database server or not. So what do? We go to the MySQL server. I hope the MySQL server window is visible to us. And we type the same command, select star from IoT MQTT. And we can see here that the one record has been inserted into our table. So what was the column here? The publisher ID, the broker ID, the subscriber ID, the topic, and the content. Now for the publisher ID, it will store the information of the publisher, client information from PAHO client information, org.eclipse.paho.client-mosquito-version-3, mosquito client, and then some values in a hexadecimal format, which is automatically doing on its own. Then this is a broker. Our broker is running on the port number 1882 on our local machine. That has got stored. Then the information about subscriber will come. Then the topic was temperature. And then the value for the content for 16 degrees Celsius. So this is the way how we carry out a communication from the publisher to the broker to the subscriber, and then subscriber connect to a database. Now, since MySQL is a free of cost, you can also use PostgreSQL SQL. That is also free of cost. You can also download MongoDB. That is also free of cost. So it depends upon whichever database. If you already have a database on your machine, good, up and running. However, if you are doing it for the first time, you don't have a database, go for MySQL. It's the simplest, easiest, lightweight database we have got available. Should not be a problem. With just the file is a bit heavy, so you need to download it once and then carry out installation on your machine. Once done, then you need to open two windows, one for broker and one for carrying out a communication from publisher to subscriber. So in this way, the program gets successfully connected. Now, another bit of troubleshooting, which I can, because what I did, I can share that at times this may happen that there could be a problem with the port numbers. So there's a file called services.msc file. So you can open it on your machine. And let's say I am MySQL server is there. I'm running, I can go to the M MySQL. Yeah. So if it is creating a problem, means you're not able to connect your front-end Java program to the back-end database, you can check it out that is your MySQL server is running or not. So if it is running, the status third column will show running. If it creates a problem, then what you can do, you can stop it and then restart it again. If it creates problem, that's a troubleshooting tip. If it is running fine, then you don't have to do anything into anything. It's all okay. But however, if you are able to, you have downloaded the jar file correctly, you have set the value of the class path variable correctly, and then also you are not able to do it. So there could be a problem with the port number on the MySQL server. So I'm typing the name of the file in the chat window, services.msc file. You can open this file on your machine and then you can check out on the port number on which the MySQL server is receiving a request. You can stop it and then restart it again so that your MySQL server can receive the data from the front-end Java program. But then having said everything here, the most important thing is the value of the class path variables. They need to be set correctly. So one I have already shared in the chat window, set class path equal to C colon IoT simulation org.eclipse.pahoo.client Moscow version 3 and the name of the jar file, then percentage, then semicolon percentage class path percentage. Actually, what does it mean? What it signifies that you are concatenating or adding a new path to the existing class path variable. So when we say semicolon percentage class path percentage semicolon, what does it mean? Ki whatever are the previous content of the class path, they should be retained as it is. And the new class value in the class path variable should be concatenated or should be added to it, so that you do not lose your previous set of the class path values, and the new values can keep on getting added to it. So this you can try it on your machine and your program should work. There should not be any other problem with that. So any doubt regarding it?